And before I start this talk, I would like to acknowledge the support of our funding bodies. First of all, the Science Foundation Ireland, and then European Council through two European projects. One is P7 project, MARINCOMP. The other one is Horizon 2020 FloTEC project. And I would like also to acknowledge the support of Marine Renewable Energy Ireland. And of course, all others here listed, including the University of Edinburgh, for hosting us during these 2 months of secondment. I will try this. So the blades are basically the main component in extracting the energy from the wind and tide. And thus they are the main drivers in the sense of loading and dynamics of the rest of the structure. And as the capture of the energy is increasing by increasing the rotor diameter, you can see that the diameter of the wind rotors is going up to 180 meters. So just to show the blade that is produced by Suslin in the middle is 45.6 meters long. That is just above half of the biggest blade produced, which is 88.4 meters. So you can imagine the size of these structures. Two of our industry partners are also shown here, Suslin and Scotrenewables Tidal Power. So in order to produce this enormous structure, there is a few things that we encounter as the main problems, and that is labor-intensive manufacturing, that adding to the cost of the production of the blades, and obviously difficult transport and installation. So there is a need actually to alternate the design of the blades in order to actually achieve the lighter blades, and but still to actually withstand the load that they will encounter. So I will first present the MARINCOMP project. I hope that Finley will take care of the other project that we are working on. So the aim of this project, as many projects I believe at this point, is basically to reduce the cost of the energy. And the main objectives are to develop and optimize carbon fiber reinforced composite materials, which are tailored to work in the harsh marine environment. And so in the sense to enable fast processing and production of these blades, to develop new software tools that will encounter for fatigue design life, and to develop the cost performance processing model for composite usage. First of all, technology evaluation cost. I haven't mentioned at the start, we actually consider only a horizontal axis turbine. The cost of the blades is 11% of all the cost of the onshore wind, but it doesn't deviate much for offshore wind as well. So the blade development actually affects the load and thus the cost of the other components. So the design basically becomes the key issue for designing the blades. So back in 2010, Gurit actually did the exercise comparing two different materials and processes, infusion blade and prepreg blade. The exercise was done on 35 meters long blade. And as you can see in the first row there, the bill of materials is actually higher for a prepreg blade. But we, if we take into account direct cost and indirect cost of the labor, we can see that the prepreg blades are actually have the lower cost. So in all, the sum is actually making, the sum of the cost is actually making a small difference. This is just to show how the production of the blades and the processes used can affect the cost, the final cost of the blade. In the same report, they actually said that for 40 meters and beyond that length blades, we can actually think of using alternative materials such as carbon, in which way the prepreg would become more feasible. So just to show you the picture, this is again done because the wind industry is more developed, so there is more information to track down out of it. This slide actually shows how the changing the thickness of the airfoil and varying the materials to the higher modulus, we can achieve the larger blade. Obviously, it's all connected with design as well. So I actually point out there are the constraints in the blade design. So for the e-glass composite blade, their length can go up to the 55 meters, after which they become unfeasible. And up to 47 meters, their design driver is natural frequency, while from there until 52 meters length, tip deflection represent the design driver, and so on, so edge fatigue. If we make the airfoil thicker, and we will have to do the aerodynamic compromise in the sense that we will have the airfoil that is not optimized, but in the sense of the structural capability of the blade, we will be on the safe side. If we introduce the higher modulus, we can go beyond the 62. When I say the higher modulus, these are the R-glass or S-glass, but then that can become more expensive. So the next study that was done on the wind turbine blades is basically a comparison between the traditionally used E-glass and carbon model. And from this graph, you can actually see how much saving can be achieved if the unidirectional composites are replaced with the carbon. So this is just to give idea what are the implications of the cost of the processing and materials. So I will talk now about the tidal blade design methodology, and this is the, let's say, simplified algorithm of doing the things. So first we start with the tidal model, from which we actually get the tidal current velocity that feeds into the hydrodynamic model, from where we are getting the local blade fluid velocities, optimal chord length and optimum pitch angle, and we get the axial and tangential forces on the blade. This feed into the structural model, where we actually generate the blade itself in the final element analysis model. And we look at the strain distributions for different load combinations on the blade. These strain distributions are then compared with the experimental fatigue testing, and that can be fed further on in fatigue life model that is basically aim of the project that we were talking at the start. So the first model is tidal model, and basically the tide varies between the maximum height and during the spring tide and mid tide, where the height is the minimum one. and by observing the velocities of the tides during a certain period of time, we can actually extract what are the tidal current velocities. Alternatively, there are tables and tidal flow atlases that can be used, but it's basically very unpredictable in the small geographical space. So as predictable energy source in comparison to wind, but still it deviates in the small geographical space. So we need a certain kind of safety factors when accounting for this. The next step is basically hydrodynamic model, and it's determining the performance of the tidal turbine blade. We are using the blade momentum theory to actually get the loading on the blades. So the method is based on the series of concentrating stream tubes, so that the blade is basically, the blade length is divided on the sections. So for each sections, we are repeating the same algorithm that is shown here. So we assume the chord length for each section, then calculate the relative velocities on the blade, then calculate the hydrodynamic forces. The next is basically checking the balance between the forces and the momentum thrust. In the case of not balanced, we are alternating the chord length and twist angle and so on. We are repeating the process. Alternatively, there is the software developed by Enrel, HARP-OPT, that can be used for these purposes. So from this model, we actually have generated the sections of the blade and the axial thrust force, which is basically linearly increasing with the length of the blade and making the flap moment, which is the greatest moment, and this moment is very important for structural design as it is the biggest towards the root of the blade. The tangential or torque force is basically the one that gives us energy. Unfortunately, it's a very, very small, but it's contributing to the edgewise moment of the blade, and it has to be considered in design as well. From there on, we are actually defining the airfoil. And the airfoil is defined so that we have the highest ratio of, or that is the best case scenario, to have the highest ratio of lift and drag force. But we have to take in account that in that case, we are going to achieve fairly thin airfoil that are not maybe suitable to accommodate the structural elements that we have to accommodate within the airfoil itself. So as the blade has to take the loading itself, also the gravitational forces and the buoyancy itself, we look at the airfoil shapes that are better accommodating the structural needs. So there is a kind of balance that has to be done between the hydrodynamic performance of the blade and structural satisfaction of the blade. So these are some of the typical airfoils, but X-foil and R-foil can be actually used because as the blade itself is the circular in circular near the root, it basically has to have a smooth transition to the actual airfoil. So we are using X-foil and R-foil to actually determine this. transition in between two. So the programs itself can generate for us the coordinates for the each section of the blade, and this forms the input for the structural design of the blade. Now, I mentioned in the beginning structural design, and I straight jumped to the final element analysis. However, there is another intermediate step, which is basically preliminary structural design, and we feel that if we add this into the game, that we actually can, even with additional step, we can actually speed up design and optimization of the blade itself. So just a little bit on the structure of the blade itself. This is internal beam. The spar caps are located here, and these are the main members that are taking the moment and axial loads imposed on the blade. The vertical here is basically presenting a shear bed, and it's there to transfer the shear forces, but it's also stopping from supplying the top and bottom airfoil. The arrangements can be only with one web, or it can have two webs. It can be also D-nose, where this web is approaching the leading edge. So basically it's incorporating in the leading edge. So in order to do the proper pre-processing of the blade or preliminary design of the blade, our task for this month and a half was basically to assess different kind of softwares to see which one is more acceptable to use, and we selected I think 15 or 17 of these softwares, of which 7 of them we assess in the sense of how it is input built, in the sense of how easy it is to basically generate, modify the geometry, generate and modify loads, and so on. We also look at the outputs that we are getting from these softwares, and we selected the core blade. Now, I have to mention that there is in-house developed software by Scotrenewables, which we are going to use and compare further on with the results obtained by the core blade. So the input is the blade geometry, loadings that basically comes from the hydrodynamic model. Material layup is basically coming either from the testing or the laminate area that we actually find the thickness, appropriate thickness of the blade in the different sections of the blade. And material characteristics. Again, they're coming from the testing. This is how it looked like a generated tidal blade, 9 meters long. The software itself, I forgot to tell, it's developed by Edinburgh and it's freely available. Can give us fast access to see how well we modeled our geometry. It also can show us if we impose the loading on the blade in the right directions and what kind of displacements we can get from the initial loading. So the outputs, these are just some of the outputs, and I'll show you now how it look like in the picture. So the software itself, once the model is put in, it can be modified very quickly and it runs in a few seconds. In the sense of alternating the thicknesses of the plies or rearranging geometry in the sense of position of the webs or testing a different kind of loading or combinations of the loading, it can be done very fast. And this is just an example of the output showing the panel thicknesses in millimeters. This is for the upper and lower airfoil and the web itself, but it can be actually plotted just to see what is happening in one plane. This is the distribution of the normal strain in top and bottom and web surfaces. Again, it can be plotted so to be visible what is happening in each separate. The normal stress, which is very important for the structural design of the spar caps, can be assessed and checked at each section separately. What is the final, it can actually give us the idea of distribution of the mass densities. Now, this comes to the slide of the cost evaluation, so the software itself can help us in the fast access or calculations of the bill of materials. So if we alternate within the software, let's say from the e-glass to carbon glass, we can actually see how the blade performs, but we actually can see what are the saving on the mass of the blade itself. So the final thing is basically final element model. And final element model can be fed from this preprocessor. Now I'm here deliberately showing this example that is not, let's say, a realistic representation of the section itself. And this is the thing that can be avoided by using a preprocessor. In the past, there was a custom to use the simplified airfoil shape to do the final element analysis. And also, as you can see, the blade here is straight, and though in the reality it's a little bit twisted, that can be also altered in the preprocessor rather than going to the expensive and hard to generate final element analysis. Also, preprocessor can actually help up with the build-up of the blade, and this is just an example of the build-up blade that is that Coblade is using, and the layup as well as characteristic of materials can be easily imported in final element analysis. So these are the findings that we are looking at when we consider the final element analysis in the sense of the principal stress distribution that can be then compared with what is tested in a lab on the small coupons. And from there on, we can actually build up different kind of scenarios, including fatigue. I was asked by Kahur to add some slides on fatigue testing and the results that we have. I didn't have the time for that. I presented those results in February in Oxford, so there are some available on the net. And soon enough we will have in Renewable Energy Journal submitting paper so on that subject. So with this I will finish this part of the talk. So this was the journey, what is encounter. Just one sentence to add that the development of the blade itself is approximately taking 9 months to develop and testing it's taking another probably 12 months itself. So with no results, but just the journey, I'm finishing this talk and I will hand on this to Finlay, which I think he will have more to say. Interesting. Thank you.
This production is brought to you by the University of Edinburgh.